Good evening to all of you and a warm welcome to our extra session on purgatory. So we begin by signing ourselves with the sign of the cross in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll join in saying Psalm 91. You who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver us from the snares of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He'll cover us with his pinions, and under his wings we'll find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a buckler. You shall not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at our side, 10,000 at our right hand, but it will not come near us. You'll only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation, no evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent. For he will give his angels charge of you, to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder. Young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Because he clings to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade. On your right hand, the sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep you alive. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Prayer to Saint Michael the Archangel. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in the day of our battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all other evil spirits who roam throughout the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Saint Francis of Assisi, pray for us. Saint Clare of Assisi, pray for us. Our Lady of Immaculate Conception, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening to all of you and a warm welcome to our session on purgatory. Now you might be wondering that we have already completed two sessions on purgatory. So what is there more to know? We have seen the teaching. So we are going to speak a little bit, which is important to understand how to use what we have learned. That means knowledge is one thing, but the application of that knowledge is very essential to know. So we have seen in these last two sessions is what is purgatory, the doctrine of purgatory. I mean, it is the dogma of the church. That means it is bound to be believed. So the church teaches us in the CCC 1030 1031, paragraph number, and 1032, it talks about the doctrine of purgatory. Right? So we have seen this. Okay, then we seen that means we believe that there is a purgatory. Okay, there is a purgatory, first thing. And second thing, the teaching is that souls there are benefited by our suffrages. Souls there are benefited by our suffrages, or rather our intercessions, our prayers. Okay, our intercessions. So our prayers promised or prescribed when we pray for a specific intention. What is our intention? The suffrages means when we are praying for a particular intention. Our intention is to deliver these souls from purgatory. Now this we know by knowledge. So these are the doctrine of the church or the teaching of the church with regard to purgatory. Okay. Then we seen also about the doctrine on indulgences. How to apply, how we are going to help the souls in purgatory. But there are many, 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 many other things, because gaining a plenary indulgence is a very, very difficult task. It's not an impossible task, but as you need to know, you need to be completely detached even from venial sin. So sometimes that may, so it may mostly we may try to be able to gain a partial indulgence, but gaining a plenary indulgence will be very difficult. Okay, not impossible, but difficult. So though the church teaches us, as I told you already, from 1st November to 8th November, every indulgence can be offered for the souls in purgatory, specifically for the holy souls. And since the Vatican has now, the Apostolic Penitentiary has granted and extended this time period for the entire month of November, that whenever you visit the graveyard in any of those days, it can be a plenary indulgence can be granted for the souls in purgatory, for the departed souls in purgatory. Okay. So now, what are the other things that we can basically do? So what we are going to see is how we are going to provide relief to these suffering souls. How we are going to. So this is the knowledge that we have, but how we are going to actually put it into practice. So we are going to look at certain things, certain other things, which is not officially the teaching of the church. I mean, it means to say that these are things which are through other teachings. You can say that they are teachings which are given to us. Okay. They are teachings given to us, but not officially made, you know, the church teaches. So it is not an official teaching of the church. So these are not doctrines of faith, but they are commonly received teachings, or maybe through the lives of the saints, through the lives, through the teachings of the saints, through the teaching of the church fathers. So that's how we understand. So as I told you, now the first question that comes, where is this place? Where is this place purgatory? So we are going to see where is this place purgatory. As I told you, these are not the church has not given any official teaching on this. So we are free to listen to the teachings of the fathers of the church or the different saints, what is their viewpoint. But this is not official teaching of the church, which means that we are bound to, not bound to believe with full faith. I mean, it is not a sin if we don't believe those things, right? So, but it is good to understand what the teachings through the common teaching, commonly received teachings of the fathers of the church are. Okay. So, first thing, to the place of purgatory. Now, where is this place? Where is purgatory located? So some, many of the saints, especially Saint Thomas Aquinas and these other saints, they say that purgatory is a place beneath the earth and above the hell. So in between this, purgatory is located. That's what they say, they teach. As I told you again, let me clarify very clearly, this is not the official teaching of the church. That means the church does not say anything with regard to where the place is. It has not given any comment or not made us to believe anything. So we are free to this thing. But the teaching, commonly received teaching, or what you say from the fathers of the church and from the saints who have seen the visions or through private revelations, the teaching is that it is commonly between earth and hell. But we are bound to believe that there is a purgatory. But where it is, we don't know. Okay? It's not, the church is not taught. So also, sometimes St. Thomas Aquinas says, St. Thomas Aquinas, remember, is a great doctor of the church. Now, doctor doesn't mean doctor in the sense of what we understand. But doctorate means is given to the people who have learned, great learning, and who have enhanced the teaching of the church, or through their learning, or through their this thing, through any of their life that they have lived, they enhance the teaching of the church. So that's why they are given the title doctor.
So not because they are some, I mean, what we have received a doctorate in theology or doctorate in this thing, not because they have done a PhD or a doctorate of like medicine. So it's not that type of a doctor. Okay, the doctors of the church are different. Currently, we have 35, I think 35 to 36 doctors we have, official doctors of the church. Okay, so I think 35, I'm not very sure of the number, but it is 35 fixed number. Okay, so now this place, purgatory, sometimes Thomas Aquinas says that the where the soul commits sin or where is their place on the earth, sometimes the soul returns back there and it has to atone for the sins in that place. So that is where the sometimes the souls are sent back. Now, as I said, again, this is not official teaching, but it is what the saints have believed. Okay, commonly received teaching. Now, what are the pains of purgatory? So we have seen the place. What are the pains in purgatory? The souls definitely undergo a cleansing fire that we have seen from the catechism. That means they are cleansed by fire. Now, this fire is much more than the earthly fire, than the material fire that we have. So what type of fire it is, we don't know. The church doesn't teach us. But the catechism says it's a cleansing fire, a purifying fire. That's what purgation means. It's a purifying fire. It purifies. Okay, it purifies these souls. Some of the saints believe that like Saint Catherine of Genoa, she says that the soul within itself undergoes this fire. Okay, it burns. It burns. Now, why does it burn? So there are two types of pains which these souls undergo. The first pain is the pain of loss. Pain of loss of what? Pain of loss of the delay, because they are not yet admitted into the beatific vision. That means they cannot still see God face to face. So that delay. So my soul is thirsting for you, O God. O God, my soul longs for you. So that pain of loss, which is there among the soul. So it is most severe among the holy souls in purgatory. Now we are on earth, so we may not be feeling that pain. Sometime when we commit, you know, when we feel everyone is abandoned, then our soul is longing and thirsting. We are so sorrowful. So much more than that sorrow which is there on earth here, or when any of our departed member, when any of our family members die. So how we feel that sorrow in our heart, much more greater than that pain is the pain of loss for the souls in purgatory. So this is what we have to understand. Pain of loss, pain of sense. The second pain is pain of sense. That means it is a kind of a mysterious fire, much more than the material fire. Okay. So they are trying to gain from this. Okay. Now, here, there is a little debate on this thing. Though it is not this, some of the teachers of the church or the in the councils, there was a discussion. Like whether, you know, is this fire a material fire? So though it is not actual doctrine or dogma of the church. So these people were, the fathers of the church were a little divided on this point. They do not admit, but they admit commonly that purgatory is a place full of labor. Now labor means what? Labor and full of sorrow. So this is what is a commonly accepted teaching. Now I'll give you a very classic example. 1 minute. Supposing now, if I am a married person and now I have to do my duties towards my children, you know, I have to go to work for them. I have to earn money for them. I have to, you know, do something for them. Now, if I am not doing this on earth, when I am alive, I will have to do this in purgatory. That is the understanding. That means whatever I have not done with a correct motive or correct intention, I will have to do, means whatever is my duty towards myself, towards my neighbor, towards God, if I don't fulfill that on earth, that the same, it will be double the amount I will have to do it on in purgatory. So that is the meaning of full of labor and full of sorrow. So here we are, you know, we are finding it very difficult to do. We don't want to do. We are lazy. We are, you know, we are lazy in doing not only our housework, but sometimes we are lazy even in doing the work of God. Maybe we are lazy in doing our, you know, our household chores. We are lazy in so many activities. So when we are doing this, remember what we are neglecting to do. These are called sin of omission. Sin of omission. Now we may take this as very a light thing or a venial sin. It may be kind of thinking as a venial sin, but when this becomes a habit, it grows into a mortal sin because it attains the term of sloth. It becomes the condition of sloth. That means we become slothful. Okay. So it is very, because then we are not ready to do any work. So it, the same thing applies in spiritual sloth. There is one is which is the physical sloth, which we are lazy to do our day-to-day work and our day-to-day activity. Another is spiritual sloth. So opposite to that is diligence. What is the virtue? Diligence. Okay. Opposite to all the vices is the virtue. Diligence. That means we need to be diligent. So if we are not diligent in the work of God, like now, if we are not saying our day-to-day prayer, then in purgatory, this is what the understanding is. This is the meaning of pain of sense. We will have to do that same work to a greater extent. Much, much, much greater extent. So I hope we understand. So it is this thing session is to make you understand that how you can avoid, how we can avoid going into purgatory. First and foremost, you know, how we can avoid if we correct our actions here on earth. So whatever we, this I gave you example only of laziness, but all the examples with whatever we are doing, our sin, I mean, whatever is our activity, whatever we are supposed to do, our day-to-day job, our day-to-day work, the commandments, obeying the command of God towards ourselves, towards our neighbor. So all these things. Now remember, this is only applicable for the venial sins and those pardoned sins that are mortal sins, which are pardoned. That means the temporal punishment. So that is the reason why we undergo those temporal punishments on earth. So we should bear that with great patience and resilience. Easier said than done. But when we have the with the grace of God, we will receive that divine help to help us to carry the cross. So the cross should be the source of refuge. So that is the meaning when these souls who have neglected to do this work on earth, when they have neglected to do the works of charity on earth, when they have neglected to pray for other souls on earth, when they have neglected their duty, they will have to atone for each and every action of theirs in purgatory. I mean, provided that they have confessed their sin and they have repented of that. Because unconfessed sin or in state of mortal sin, it will directly go to hell. There is no chance of being, this thing going into purgatory too. So we have to understand this very clearly. So this is the pain of sense that they experience. So some saints, like now, supposing now if my tongue. Now, what is the tongue used for? The Holy Scripture tells us. Why is the tongue given to us? You and I, in the book of Sirach, it clearly tells us. My tongue is given so that I might praise God. My tongue is given to glorify God. My tongue is not given for backbiting. My tongue is not given for gossiping. My tongue is not given to malign other people's name. My tongue is not given for slander. When we are doing this, I will tell you of the examples of certain saints who have seen the soul suffering in purgatory. When we are using these instruments of God, any of our organs, in the wrong purpose, in purgatory, the punishment is like that. Nails are taken and pierced on the tongue. So because we have used our tongue to defame our neighbor, we have used our tongue to tell lies, we have used our tongue to curse others. So remember, what is, now this is not what I am saying. That's why, as I said, this is not a teaching of the church. This is what the holy fathers, I mean the saints who have seen. So the punishment in purgatory is for such souls is that their tongue is brought out, drawn out, though it is the only soul which is there. But it is as if it is experiencing in the body. Body is in the grave, remember. But the soul is undergoing this torture. So that is the pain which certain saints have seen that the souls undergo. So the pain is very, very severe. So the pain, it is as if, you know, they are experiencing that burning. They are experiencing that burn. They are experiencing. So that's why I said it would be wise and prudent for us to, you know, not to dismiss these things, not to think that there is. So there is what the church, what the fathers and what the saints in their visions have seen what happens. So whether do we really understand? Because maybe we take things in a very easy go manner. So we have taken in a very easy go manner. So we have to understand, unless we have true charity in our heart, love of God completely filled, and then we atone for our sins. Okay. So I hope this is understood, that the pains. Now, how long we shall be there, we do not know anything about duration. As I told you, what Our Lady told Lucia and Jacinta, Francesco and Jacinta and Lucy about the Emilia, that she would be till the end of time. So we really don't know the time or the duration. But we know why for sure, Saint Augustine. Saint Augustine, when his mother died, he was converted at that point of time. For the next 30 years, Saint Augustine, in his Confessions, in his book, if you read, there is a book called Confessions of Saint Augustine. He wrote that for the next 30 years, he did not stop praying for his mother. So his mother requested that only you do one thing for me, that you remember me at the altar. So he prayed unceasingly for 30 years. 30 years she prayed for his conversion, remember. Then 30 years after her death, he continued to pray for her soul to be delivered. So by this we understand that means how long. So we really don't know the time period. 30 years means according to our timetable. But there, even a second is much more than what is a second on the earth. So because there is no time. So we have to understand. So the pain is much more severe, much more a longer duration. So we have to understand. As I said, we do not know the time. That is not what we are. It is not a defined any doctrine of faith that we are supposed to believe. Okay. But it is the commonly expressed teachings, what the fathers have understood. Okay. Now, what are the pains, as I already told you? So, now, what is the state of souls in purgatory? So, we know a few things about that. What are the state of the souls? How are they? What is happening to them in purgatory? So, certain things we know about them. What is it that we know? They are certain. What these souls are certain? They are certain that their salvation is sure. That means now they cannot lose their salvation. We on this earth work out your salvation with fear and trembling, Saint Paul tells us. But the souls in purgatory do not have to fear because now they know they are assured of their salvation. So they do no longer, because they have persevered. They have persevered till the end in grace. They have persevered till the end. So our Lord, what did our Lord say? He who shall persevere till the end shall be saved. So the souls are very sure that now they shall see God, despite it being delayed, but they will see God. So they are assured. So they don't. So this is the first thing. They are sure of their salvation. Second thing, they are confirmed in grace. That means now they are in the friendship of God. They are in the friendship of God. So they are confirmed in grace. So they cannot be, again lose it. No sin can tempt them now. No sin is going to haunt them. So there is no question of probation. We are on this earth in a time of probation, okay? Or there is no thought of temptation which is going to overtake them. So this all things, so they are free from. So temptation is over, time of probation is over, all this is over for them. Because so they are confirmed in grace. The third thing is they bear sufferings. We know that they bear suffering with greatest patience. Why? Because to satisfy the justice of God. Because they accept it as the justice of God. Because God is just in sending them to purgatory. Okay, so they understand this. So they bear it patiently. All sufferings are borne patiently. Okay, the fourth thing is that they exercise act of faith, charity, faith and hope. Though they do not yet see God, but they are exercising all these acts. Because now they are assured of their salvation. So how much more we need to be doing for them. But now as we know that the time, once we die, there is no more chance to merit. There is no more chance to merit. That means you cannot gain any merit. Okay. So only the souls, the living can merit. So that's the reason why we have to pray for the dead. So it is our duty to pray for the dead. So what do we have to do? So it is the faith, but as I said, it is a matter of faith. This is the doctrine of faith defined by the Council of Florence and Council of Trent, that the souls in purgatory can be helped by the suffrages, that is the intercession of the faithful on earth. Okay, so we know that very clearly. So now, how to offer these suffrages, how to offer these in the, means of intercession, what we have to do. So the church teaches us, okay. So how we are going to do that? So that is what we are going to see. The Holy Fathers divided the means of helping the suffering souls into three kinds. First is the most important thing by which we can help the holy souls is the holy sacrifice of the Mass. There is nothing greater than the Holy Eucharist. Nothing greater than the Holy. I'm going to discuss this later, how we can this thing. So three kinds. Then the prayers and works. The prayers. Very important. Prayers and works of expiation. The prayers and works of expiation. Okay. For instance, what are the prayers and works? Almsgiving. Okay. Almsgiving, fasting, pilgrimages. All these are very, very essential for helping the souls in purgatory. Okay.
So we understand this very clearly. The holy sacrifice of the Ma, the prayer and works of expiation. So prayer, this is the third one. Prayers and third one is works of expiation. Holy sacrifice of the Mass, first one. Second thing, prayers. And third, works of expiation. That means almsgiving, fasting, pilgrimage. All these benefit the souls in purgatory. So this is what we call applying how we can do charity for the souls in purgatory. Apart from what we have learned, the teaching or the dogma. Okay. So now we are going to see each of these things. So the first important thing that we are going to do. So I'll discuss this holy sacrifice of the Mass later. So these are the general means. The general means. What do you call it? General means by which we can help the souls in purgatory. Right. So the first thing are now, as we know, by prayers we can satisfy for. Now, important thing to understand that whatever we do, almsgiving and all, the merits are personal. We gain some merit from them. But we can offer the satisfaction of those merits, which is another blessing by, given by God to us, the satisfaction which is there for that work that we have done. It can be applied as a form of intercession by prayer for those souls in purgatory. That is what we can do. Merit strictly can't be given to the other soul. Whatever I merit by my good deed can't be transferred to the another living person or to the souls in purgatory. But the satisfaction of that work. So actually each work, each almsgiving, each prayer has two things. One is the merit that we gain and one is the satisfaction through which we gain. That means it can atone for our sins. So I can apply that satisfaction for another soul in purgatory. Okay, but how we have to do that? So what is the condition that we need to do that? That we have to see. Okay, so atonement is what? That means when we atone means it is a reparation. Like we repair the damage, as I told you about the broken window. Reparation of an offense, of any offense. What offense? Against the justice of God by some work of penance. So when we do any work of penance, we repair for that offense, whatever offenses we have done. So in through this, we will gain merit first and foremost. So any sinner also can repent of his sin. He reconciles by doing penitential work. Okay, he reconciles with God. And then the satisfaction which comes. So this can be applied to himself or he can apply the satisfaction of this. Because double effect. One is the merit he gains for himself in the sight of God. And the satisfaction which he, what through the work that he has performed will increase. So, but he can apply this thing to the souls in purgatory. Not the merit. Merit cannot be given to any other person. Okay. Merit which is there strictly for that person itself. Okay. So now, the first, what are the means? General means by which we can help the souls in purgatory. We seen the special means, most important thing, but now general means. First is a Catholic burial. Now, as I told you last time, expensive flowers, floral decoration, tombstones, these all things have no value for the dead. These may satisfy our pride, or maybe our ego, or maybe we want to show how good we are and what we are doing. But let me very clearly, the fathers of the church and the saints say these have no value in the sight of the dead because it really does not bring them anything. It will give them nothing. So we have to understand that these may satisfy our whatever we. Why it does not satisfy them? Because remember, when we make this thing of baptism, we say we will renounce the Satan and all his works and the all his pomps. So all these are pompous things. Okay, all these are works of great, great things in the world. In the eyes of the world, people will see, oh, so because people have to see, so I have to do. Such type of a thinking is completely in the eyes of men. But in the sight of God and the sight of the souls, it is of no value. Zero value. It has absolutely no value. So we have to understand that all these things. Remember the scripture, vanity of vanity. The preacher says vanity. All things are vanity. So whatever we do, this may be showing how great we are, how good we are. And you know, we may show to the people. But in the sight of God and for that soul, it has zero value and zero benefit. So it is of nothing going to help. So a very important thing is to have a Catholic burial. Okay. So we can do that. So we have to pray. Okay. So we have to give alms for them. Next thing is prayer. Okay. The next second thing is prayer. How prayer will help them now? We know
in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 17. The word of God tells us, St. Paul tells us, pray without ceasing. Unceasingly we have to pray, okay? Pray without ceasing. Then John 16 verse 24. The word of God tells us very clearly, ask and you shall receive. Okay? Ask and you shall receive. So prayer is the elevation of our heart to God. So we have to pray unceasingly. Ask and you shall receive and your joy will be full. 16 verse 24. So that means we have to pray to God. Remember, now the saints in heaven, they cannot atone for the sins. They cannot atone for the sins of the souls in purgatory. Okay, so they can only beg God for his mercy and intercession. Through the intercession, they can ask God. And then God may be moved and he may listen to the prayer. So they may beg God to listen to the prayer of the militant church. That means we on earth. So strictly speaking, it is the duty of the faithful on earth to pray for the souls in purgatory. Because the triumphant church, the church in heaven cannot. They can only intercede. They can ask. Strictly, they cannot atone for the souls in purgatory. So they cannot do any work of penance. So we have to understand this very clearly. So it is our bounty duty. It is our duty to pray for the souls in purgatory out of charity. Okay. So because we are members of the militant church. Okay. So to obtain the hearing of our prayers now. So we have to continually pray. So if you ask the Father in my name, he will grant it. Okay. So we have to ask the Father in his name. So the saints in heaven can pray and ask God to listen to the prayers of the faithful on earth. So when we pray on earth, the saints can intercede and ask Abba Father, the Trinity, to listen to our prayers. So when we are praying, but what is the condition? In what state should we be? For our prayers to be heard, it should be that we should be a member of the church. Okay. That means we should be first a member of the church. Second thing, if we are not alive, if we are dead, no merit is there. Merit is gone because the time for merit is over. Okay. The time for merit is over. So there is no increase of merit in the next world. So we have to strictly be a member of the militant church, or we have to be a member of the church militant. So this has to be understood. Second thing, the person praying, whoever is praying should be in a state of grace, because if we are in a state of sin, our prayer will not be answered. Okay, our prayer will not be answered. So we have to be in a state of grace. Unless the prayer is for our own repentance, then the prayer is definitely heard by God. But if we are in a state of sin, our prayer for the souls in purgatory will not be answered. So we need to be in a state of grace. Without it, all the works that we do, any work of God, if we do in a state of sin, it is zero value. It is fruitless. It has no fruit. So they are dead in the sight of God. Okay. And inoperative for heaven. Our prayer should be, next thing, that our prayer should be voluntary. It should not be forced. Not because I have told you or because you are listening to the session on purgatory, so you are doing it. That has no value. It should be voluntary. It should come from your heart. It should come from your will, free will. Okay. Whatever is done by force or by, because we are telling you, if you are doing it, it has no value and no merit. So such prayer is of no value. So it should be voluntary. Fourth thing, that it to be meritorious, the prayer should be addressed to God from a love of God, because of the love of God. Okay. Because of love of God, we should be able, and for his greater glory. So because of love of God, not because of love of the souls, but because of love of God and for the greater glory of God, greater glory of God. Okay, so because we love God, so from a supernatural motive, so these are the four ways by which our prayer can become meritorious, or else our prayer will not become meritorious in the sight of God. It will not gain that merit. So we have to understand that first of all, we should belong to the militant church, which we are. We should be in a state of grace. Okay, we have to ask God to give us a state of grace. We should pray voluntarily. That means it should not be forced. Okay, not out of force. And we should do it because we love God and because for his greater glory. Because we want that these souls must unite and must go to God. So God's glory should be there. So keeping that in mind, when we pray, definitely the souls in purgatory receive great blessing. Otherwise, if we are praying, our prayer is of no value in the sight of God. So we have to understand these very important point, why we have to pray. So that means we should pray out of a supernatural motive. Not to increase our own pride, or we are praying so many rosaries, we are praying so many divine mercies, we are praying this. What your right hand does, your left hand should not know. So we should not be that we are saying so many I believe or so many stations of the cross. That is of no value unless we are desiring for the love of God and out of greater glory of God. God should be glorified. So when God is glorified, then automatically all our prayer becomes meritorious. So any act that we do, even this teaching that I do, if I do it out of my own glory, or if I'm trying to show how I can teach, this is of no value. But rather, I and even you who are listening should come to listen because you love God, because we want that God's name be glorified. So we should be able to carry out the works of God in a proper way. If we are listening to that because of this, or if we are only listening because we want to increase our knowledge, it is not a right intention. Our intention is not right. But rather, our knowledge should be so that we should be able to do the work of God in a more proper way. Then we are really having this desire. If we have this desire, then surely our prayer and all the works that we do brings great glory to God. So I hope you have understood the second point. Now the third point is, so what type of prayers you can recite? The best form of prayer, as I've already told you last time, is the rosary. Then the stations of the cross are there. So they have powerful effect. Most important also is to recite for the dead is the De Profundis. Psalm 130. Okay, Psalm 130. So out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, listen to my prayer. Okay, so this is the prayer which it begins. From the depths I cry to you, O Lord. We sing that hymn. So out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Listen to my prayer. Listen to my pleading, O Lord. Okay, so it's very important to pray such prayers. These are very powerful prayers. When we are praying the rosary, we seen that we gain a plenary indulgence. Okay. The third thing is the official prayer of the church. Now we know that the priest during the Mass, the Holy Eucharist, the official prayer of the church is there, right? So what is the official prayer of the church when they say, remember the departed, so the priest says, remember our departed brother and sisters who have gone before us, okay? And then they pause, then they take the names of all the departed. That point of time, you can offer all the departed souls from our family. Every all departed souls, you can take their name and offer when the priest is saying. So for all the holy souls in purgatory in general, we can pray during that time when the prayer is said for the remembrance. Remember our departed brothers and sisters. Okay. So this is the official prayer of the church. Okay. Official prayer of the church for the souls in purgatory. So that means the Holy Eucharist basically. Then the fourth thing is having recourse to Blessed Virgin Mary. The most powerful is having a devotion to Mother Mary. So we all know about the Brown Scapular. The privileges or the Sabbatine privilege. Maybe in some later section, I will talk about the Sabbatine privilege when we talk on sacramentals. So this is not a proper occasion to talk. But as I would say that the Brown Scapular, the promise is that whoever wears the Brown Scapular and who dies will not suffer the fire of hell, provided he is fulfills the Sabbatine privilege. I mean, he follows the Saturday fasting and the devotion. Okay, so with that, we can escape. So that means any person who dies wearing the Brown Scapular and who fulfills the Sabbatine privilege can enter after his death immediately on that following that Saturday, that Mother Mary will descend. The teaching is this, that Mother Mary will come. It is the belief that Mother Mary comes into purgatory and she takes that faithful soul into heaven. Okay, she conducts that soul into heaven. So that is what is the Sabbatine privilege which talks. That may be in some later section I will talk about. And also all those who are dedicated or devoted to the Blessed Virgin Mary. So all those who are reciting the rosary and all these things. So that point of time, the promise is there also that they will be taken into. So speedy release from purgatory. All those who wear the scapular of Mount Carmel or the Brown Scapular. Right. So that is the promise which is given by Our Lady because she's so deeply in concern. So as the word of God tells us in Sirach 24 verse 8, I have penetrated into the bottom of the deep. Okay, then the saints and suffering souls, as I told you, by themselves, they can only intercede, they can ask. So they beg for God's mercy and they ask, beg God to listen to the prayers of the on the earth. So that's how they are praying before the throne of God. So in the book of Revelations, chapter 6, verse 6 to 9, we see that, you know, all the midst of the throne, the four living creatures and the ancients, and they are all are reciting, and then they are having the harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. So these are the prayers of the saints. If you read Revelations chapter 6, verse 6 to 9 onwards, you find that means they are praying. So they are praying, offering all the merits of Jesus Christ and all the merits which they have gained through the life, their holy life that they have lived. So that is useful for satisfying for the souls in purgatory. So we can ask the saints to intercede. Okay. So the suffering souls are definitely loved by the saints in purgatory. Then the next thing is the angels. Same way the angels also help the souls in purgatory. If we have a devotion, so particular devotions to particular angels definitely helps us to conduct the souls in purgatory. Now, so we have seen the fourth. The fifth is the saints. Like the prayer of Saint Gertrude. So prayer of Saint Gertrude is believed to release 1,000 souls from purgatory. Each time that the prayer is said, so then 1,000 souls are delivered from purgatory. As I told you, these are all private revelations. Okay, these are all private revelations. Then the angels are able to help the souls in purgatory. If you have particular devotion, especially to Saint Michael the Archangel, he is believed to conduct the souls to the judgment. This thing, so that point of time, he can help. Then we also have, if we join confraternities. There are, I last time mentioned to you about the Purgatorian Arch Confraternity, which is located on Papa Stronsay Island in an island in England, okay, near England. So Papa Stronsay. So there are like that Holy Souls Sodality, Holy Souls Association. So all these are there. So if you join one of these, you become a member of these, you automatically gain, you offer masses for them and you gain in the good works of theirs and you pray for the souls in purgatory. The next means is holy water. Holy water is a very, very essential way that when we go to graves, if we sprinkle, you know that the priest will be sprinkling holy water. But even if we have any holy water with us, if we sprinkle, then they receive great benefit from the holy water. So I have already mentioned to you in the last time. Then the next point is candles. Blessed candles when we light. So from Exodus chapter 25, verse 31 and 37. Verse 35 and 37. So when we light holy candles, it's very important because Christ is the light. So when we are lighting the candle, that means we are illuminating those souls who are there. Okay. So very important for us to burn holy candles. So what the scripture tells us, thou shalt make a candlestick of beaten work of finest gold. Thou shalt make 7 lamps and set them upon the candlestick to give light over again. So these lamps are supposed to be burned continually. Okay. And Aaron and his son shall order it that it may give light before the Lord until morning. And it should be a perpetual observance throughout the successions among the children of Israel. So the lighting of candle is blessed candles is very, very important. So when we light these souls in purgatory, definitely gain a lot there. Their souls are they have given grace. Okay. So it's a pious custom acceptable for the souls in purgatory. Then another important thing is, so it is beneficial for the souls in purgatory. So certain people would light on, like now, any feast of Our Lady on Saturdays dedicated to Our Lady. So they would light in honor of the soul or Our Blessed Virgin Mary that she should deliver the souls in purgatory. They made a promise. See, we should not make a promise rashly. We should think properly. But they used to make a promise that they will light every Saturday one candle for the soul in purgatory in the honor of Blessed Virgin Mary. So considering that as a pious work, as a pious deed, Our Lady would deliver those souls from purgatory. So maybe we can make a small chit writing the name of the departed soul whom we want to pray for. Keep it under that candle and burn a candle in honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Okay, on Saturdays. So we can do this pious activity. So definitely these are all pleasing works to God and it benefits the souls in purgatory. And short prayer we can say for them, eternal rest grant to their souls, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them and may their souls, as we already know this prayer. So the indulgences I have already discussed. So that is the 10th point. So I'm not going to go into detail about talking again in that. As you already know, we can pray. Already this is the period of the Navina of the souls in purgatory. You can gain indulgence. I have already put that in a great detail and spoken about it, right? Then fasting. Now, very important is about fasting, okay? So what we have to do? So normally we know that we enjoy in a lot of sensual pleasures, lot of our senses, whatever our appetite desire, we want to eat this, we want to do that. So how can we benefit? So how can we benefit to the by chastising, by mortifying our flesh, by mortification of our senses. So when we mortify our senses, whatever we desire, when we give up, that point of time, that soul in purgatory can gain a lot. Supposing if now that soul was indulging into overeating, or if that soul was, you know, eating a lot of things without, you know, so in a glutton way, or was not doing any fasting. So if we fast on behalf of those souls, definitely this is a very meritorious act. So when we pamper our flesh by, you know, going on without fasting, that point of time, we are satisfying our appetite, our sensual appetite, okay, for momentary gratification. So in atonement for this, we can satisfy for all the vain pleasures that the souls have done. So to feed the hungry. So when we feed the hungry, you know, the corporal and the spiritual works of mercy, these can be applied to the souls in purgatory. These can be applied. Not only they gain merit, but we can apply. So those souls who, when they were on earth, neglected the works of mercy, when we do that on their behalf, their punishment can, or their suffering in purgatory can be reduced. That is the understanding. So what we are supposed to do is to offer it for them. So whenever we do any work, when we give it for them, it automatically be. Now see, it may not, God, it is into God's hand. We may offer, but it is into God's hand to decide whether he wants to offer that or no. It is not in our hand. So we cannot choose. We may offer it for a particular soul in our family member or anybody, because they are the closest to us. It is out of charity. We are bound to pray for them first. But it is only in the hand of God, and for God to decide whether he wants to apply to that soul or whether he doesn't want to apply. So it is not in our hand. But it is a good thing or a pious work to do such a thing. Okay. So this thing will count for us. So whenever we rebel against our flesh, so against that we can do fasting. So we can offer it up for the Lord. Okay. So in order that our fasting should be beneficial for the suffering souls, it is not just enough for us to, you know, abstain from food and drink, but we must also refrain from committing sin. Because if we are committing sin and then we are fasting and doing penance, it's of no value in the sight of God. Okay, it is of no value in the sight of God. So when we fast and, you know, we fast from food and drink, we should also not commit sin. So if we are committing sin and fasting and doing, you know, it is of no value. So we have to understand. So Isaiah chapter 58 verse 6. Isaiah chapter 58 verse 6, 7. This clearly tells us what fasting it is. Is not this rather the fast that I have chosen? Loose the bands of wickedness, undo the bundles that oppress. Let them that are broken go free and break asunder every burden. Deal thy bread to the hungry and bring the needy and the harborless into your house. When anyone sees somebody naked, cover him and despise not your own flesh. So when you do these works, automatically that is called through fasting. So if you want to know what is through fasting, please, this is your homework. Isaiah 58 verse, entire chapter you can read. It talks about fasting. What is through fasting? Through fasting versus false fasting. What is the meaning of really doing fasting? You will come to know. So it is not just abstaining from something. So you will understand what true fasting means against hypocritical fasting. So if we are conducting sin, if I am fasting from food and I am getting angry and I am shouting and I am blasting and I am cursing, that fasting is of no value, zero value. Okay. So all that fasting is gone down the drain. So we have to understand very clearly what fasting is all about. Okay. Then almsgiving. So almsgiving, the scripture tells us, in Sirach chapter 3 verse 33, water quenches a flaming fire and alm delivers from sins. So when we give almsgiving, it delivers us from many sins. Okay, when we give almsgiving for the sake of the souls in purgatory, when we have that intention for the love of God, basically we have to offer it for the love of God, for goodness of, for the glory of God. That point of time, those souls are benefited, because if they have neglected to give any almsgiving or do any good works of mercy, then definitely the, you know, we can do that on behalf of them. Then Tobit chapter 4 verse 18. Tobit chapter 4 verse 18. Lay out thy bread and thy wine upon the burial of a just man. So, you know, offer that for those, for the people who cannot eat or cannot drink. Not only for your near and dear ones, but offer it for those who cannot, because then they can pray for that soul. So that is a holy thought. That is a holy intention. They can pray for that soul. Then Tobit chapter 12 verse 8 and 9. Tobit chapter 12 verse 8 and 9. Sirach chapter 3 verse 33, Sirach chapter 3 verse 33, Tobit chapter 4 verse 18, and Tobit chapter 12 verse 8 and 9. So I'm not having much time, but I will just read it out. Prayer is good with fasting. Listen to this word of God. Prayer is good with fasting and alms more than to lay up treasure of gold. So more than collecting treasures in our bank balance and bank account, prayer is good and alms is more. For alms delivers from death. So the amount of almsgiving that you give will deliver our soul from death. Okay. And the same, that is, it purges away sins. So it cleanses the sins which we are going to undergo punishment. It cleanses our sin. Same thing we can apply for the souls in purgatory. Please understand. Very important scripture. Tobit chapter 12 verse 8 and 9. And make us to find mercy and life everlasting. So if we want to enter into eternal life, all those who are having their wealth can use it for a good purpose. They can use it for a great purpose, for giving out, for almsgiving. I mean, give alms only to the right place, not giving anything and everywhere, because that is not going to benefit us. Remember, there is a scripture for that also. In one of the other sessions, I will discuss about this. So if you are giving alms, then it is misused, then that we may think, okay, it's okay if I give. But we have to understand what is the, so that scripture very clearly tells us not to give the alms to the wicked people. So, or else that almsgiving has no value in the sight of God. There is a word of God for that also. Okay. Tobit chapter 4 verse 7. Tobit chapter 4 verse 7. The scripture tells us give alms out of your substance. Means out of all your general, whatever goods you have. And turn not away thy face from any poor person. For so it shall come to pass that the face of the Lord shall not be turned from thee. So when we give, all these corporal and spiritual works of mercy will be remembered in the sight of God. Whatever we do for the glory of God and out of the love of, remember, you have to do it for the glory of God and love of God. If these intentions are not there, all the alms giving and fasting and prayer, everything is zero. Anything done only to increase our collar or to make ourselves proud or to make ourselves great in the sight of others and to make our name known in the sight of others is of no value in the sight of God. Such works are zero works or zero value. Okay. They are as good as straw, which when burned down will burn down nothing. It will burn into nothing. Okay, so we have to understand this very clearly. Okay, then Holy Communion we can offer. Now I know we are not able to receive Holy Communion. Okay, Sirach chapter 3, as I mentioned, Sirach chapter 3, verse 33. Sirach chapter 3, verse 33. Okay, now Holy Communion is most beneficial. So whenever we receive Holy Communion, we can ask God to remember the souls in purgatory. So many saints have done this. Okay. So when we receive Holy Communion, we can pray for the souls in purgatory to be liberated. So remember, the state of grace is necessary. Any of the good works to be done are profitable for the souls in purgatory. If we are not in the state of grace, definitely these works are of no merit in the sight of God. And the most powerful means to aid the holy souls in purgatory is definitely the holy sacrifice. So as many number of masses that we offer for the souls in purgatory, it is going to give them great. So no one can compare to the amount of what the mass can do. A single mass, I mean, offered. So that's why it is also good practice. You may have heard only of offering masses for the dead, but it is very important to offer mass while you are alive. Offer masses for yourself, so that you can gain, because we do not know after we die whether anybody may offer mass for us or no. Because as the teaching is nowadays not being there, so people do not know. So offer masses for the dead, especially the mass when they die, immediately mass of requiem. So remember your departed souls in purgatory and offer for your family members as many masses as possible for their relief. So maybe you were not knowing this teaching before. So now may God bless all of us and give us the grace to remember all what has been taught to us. So now to conclude this session, we will recite Psalm 130. Psalm 130. The De Profundis. For some of you, it may be Psalm 129. Out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning. More than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy. And with him is plenteous redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto their souls, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May their souls rest in peace. Amen. May the souls of all the faithful departed to the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. Please do not forget to pray for the holy souls in purgatory. As we are approaching November 1st, 2nd, you know all the indulgences. Already we have had an extensive session on that. So I'm not going to repeat that. Please go back to whatever you have written, the notes that you have taken down, and apply for the souls in purgatory. For the parishioners of St. John the Baptist, definitely, as they are going to get a chance to visit the cemetery, they can pray for the holy souls in purgatory. So good night, and God bless us all. And may we pray for more and more souls to be released from purgatory. Good night, and thank you. God bless you all.